Welcome to Microsoft Mechanics Live. Coming up, we'll discuss how Microsoft Teams is built to ensure a secure and compliant collaboration environment, and how you can manage Microsoft Teams with the controls needed while keeping a great experience for your users. We're going to share the newest security and compliance features, such as data loss prevention, information barriers, and new retention policies. Now, we're also digging into the controls and tools, including Network Planner, Advisor for Teams, Enhanced Calling, Device Management, and here to show us how, we're joined by Anne Michels from the Teams group. Welcome, Anne.
Thank you. It's great to be back.
Thank you. It's been too long since you've been on the show. All right. So we talk a lot on the show about how Teams really can help everyone easily access information and collaborate with one another. But the ability to securely and compliantly manage Teams is kind of something super important as part of the story as well. Can you share with us some of the controls that you use then as an admin in Teams and why these are important?
Absolutely. So as you all know, Teams gives users the tool they need to work effectively. But when end users use Teams, it also means they don't need to use those consumer-grade products that do not always meet the security and compliance requirements of your organization. And that is very important. We have built Teams so that you can stay in control. I am here in the Microsoft Teams Admin Center. And in here, you can manage Teams, messaging policies, org-wide settings, and much more. And we continue to add more functionality here to enable you to more granularly manage the service.
All right, so can you show us some of the new controls and capabilities of Teams?
So let's start with one that I know a lot of you have been waiting for, private channels. I am sure you all heard the announcement earlier this week that private channels are now generally available in Microsoft Teams. So here in the Admin Center, in Teams policies, this is where you can manage what users can do in channels and in Teams. And we have added a new global setting that allows you to enable or disable the creation of private channels in your tenant.
All right, so I'm going to show you what it looks like from the user perspective. So now you can see a couple of things here, indications of private channels. I'll just zoom in so you can see the lock. So the lock icon's right here. And basically, I've got a nice little circle around it. Basically, you can see any time a private channel's been created. The nice thing is it's really easy to make one of these. So I'll go ahead and add a channel. When I do that, I'm actually given a couple of different options. I have to give it a name, so I'll just call it demo. And then we'll go ahead and give it either a standard or a private demarcation. Now, the nice thing with private is once I've built this channel, I can basically invite just the people within a larger team who need to communicate within that private channel. So you've got kind of private access and groups within your teams. But now I know that we've added a lot more in the areas of policy management. Can you show us what else is new there?
So let me jump into PowerShell. We're adding new policy assignment capabilities. In the past, when you wanted to assign a policy to a group, you first had to pipeline it down to the members of the group before you could actually assign the policy. Now, you can assign a policy to a group with a single PowerShell commandlet. And I know this is a capability that many of you have been waiting for because it will save many of you a lot of time scripting.
Right, and you can get all this obviously from the PowerShell gallery. You can basically down and inject the module that you need. So this gives you then the control over the policies, how they're applied across teams, and then the groups that are and the groups that are using automation. But how do these policies then compare? Because we were talking about Teams policies and some things in the Teams admin portal with some of the things that we set through the Microsoft 365 Compliance Center or Security Center.
So the way how to think about policies is that the policies that are specific to an app or a service, like, for example, private channels, you will configure them in their specialist portal, like we saw with private channels in the Admin Center, right, in the Microsoft Teams Admin Center. But then for any policies that are cross Microsoft 365, you configure them here in the Microsoft 365 Compliance Center. Here you can find things like retention, for example. And the nice thing is when you set a policy here, you can set it once, and it will directly apply across all the different apps in Microsoft 365, including Teams, Outlook, and SharePoint, for example. Talking about retention, we have actually added the capabilities or enhanced the capabilities that you have here. You can now create a deletion policy that is as short as one day.
All right, so I can see this coming in handy, especially for things like privileged information situations, for mergers and acquisitions, also legal scenarios. This is a super handy feature in terms of having that short retention policy.
Exactly. And to add to this, early this year, we added data loss prevention for chat and channel conversations. So as you all know, we have had DLP on email and on files for a while, but now you can also block messages that contain confidential information. Here, I'm again in the Microsoft 365 Compliance Center, and I have a policy that blocks any messages that contain financial information, like, for example, credit card numbers. Jeremy, why don't you show us what the end user experience looks like?
All right, so I'm going to show you a couple things here. So here I'm actually logged in, and I can see that I've tried to send a social security number, and you can see that it was blocked. So I'll just zoom into this. This time I'll be able to draw a better square than before, I hope. So we'll go ahead and do that. You can see here that because the actual message contained a social security number, it got blocked, and you can actually see that. Now, and I can get a nice policy tip here to see why that was blocked, and I get that here as well. So I'll cancel out of that. And if I go into what Nestor saw on his side, you can see that the message was actually blocked due to sensitive content. So he gets a notification effectively that I've sent something, but it's actually indicated there's something in there that was sensitive and it shouldn't have been sent. Because sometimes people just don't have that filter in terms of knowing what the right thing is to send in chat. And a lot of times, you know, chat seems like a very familiar, kind of easygoing place, but you still don't want to send things like credit card information or social security numbers or ID numbers over that as well. But now sensitive information can be flagged for both files as well as chat. So you can also get roll-up reports, and you can also do some pretty cool things in terms of things like safe links as well as part of this. Safe links is actually part of Teams as well, and it will flag you just like safe links would do in Office, and basically you'd have the ability to get links that aren't safe blocked through the experience there as well. It's all part of advanced threat protection, part of Office 365. It's going to protect users from opening malicious links. Now, what else can we do in terms of protecting Teams information?
We've delivered another highly requested capability called information barriers, which prevents certain internal teams from communicating with each other.
All right, so when would I need something like information barriers?
So let me give you an example.
Okay.
Sometimes you need to limit information sharing between certain segments of a business. That is
right.
Often the case because you need to adhere to ethical walls, regulations, or industry standards. For example, you might be a bank, and you cannot have your financial advisors team talk to the merger and acquisitions team. And that is exactly what we prevent here with the script.
Okay, so one of the things I can do then as a user, so let me go into chats here. I'm going to try to actually chat with Alex. He's actually a suggested member and participant. He's in my directory, obviously, because it's Alex. He's in another segment that I'm not allowed to chat with. So I can see here that I'm actually not allowed by a policy to talk to Alex. You can see I've got a nice policy statement again. And the other thing is if I wanted to go into a team, say, and add Alex into that team, then if I'm going to manage that, we'll go ahead and try to add member of Alex. So we'll go ahead and try that out. And Alex won't be able to be added to the team. We'll see here in just a second. There we go. Unable to add the user due to the admin settings that we have. So now even though Alex is in the same group, it's not going to work. Now if I cancel out of that one but try to join somebody else who's in my segment, so we'll try Joni Sherman, we'll add her to the team. And this is going to actually work in this case unless she's already been added. She hasn't been, so I can add her to the team as a member or an owner, as you'd expect. Close, and now she's actually part of the team. So you can see selectively, depending on the segment the user's in, I'll actually be able to add some people that are in my segment and not add others if they're part of a barriered off segment effectively.
And it doesn't just work in channel and chat conversations. We are also working on bringing information barriers to files in Teams. So not only will your chats be protected, but also the SharePoint files attached on the team SharePoint. So if a user then tries to share a file in Teams, information barriers will block that according to the policy.
Right, this is a really great capability. It's available across Teams and also SharePoint. So if you want to, let's shift gears and go to one of my favorite topics, deployment. I know we're doing a lot there in order to streamline getting Teams rolled out and deployed, specifically for folks that are coming from Skype for Business. Can you tell us what's new there?
So for those of you who are on that journey, we've added a few more options. Here you can see the controls that you have as you make your transition. As you can see, there are now 5 options to help you control the level and pace of your organization moving to Teams. We have added 2 new coexistent modes recently. You can now, for example, continue to use Skype for Business for meetings and use Teams for group collaboration only as a first step.
Right, and now we actually have more options in terms of different types of organizations that are out there. I know a lot of people are transitioning from PBX systems to Teams and adding Teams devices as well. So what's new on the device management front?
Microsoft Phone System is now even better. We have delivered over 10 updates in the last 3 months, and this includes things like enhanced delegation and reverse number lookup. Check out the new phone system administration experience here. A lot of these capabilities, they will actually probably look familiar to you because we have brought them over from the Skype for Business Admin Center. But we have also added a couple of new ones, like, for example, dynamic emergency policies.
Right, but you mentioned something I think near and dear to a lot of people, meeting room devices. Now, setting up these rooms and really keeping them running can be challenging, right?
Right, but it shouldn't be. And that's why you will soon be able to manage your Teams Rooms devices directly from the admin center, from inciting configurations to restarting devices and monitoring updates. You will have access to all the key configuration tools that you need directly from here.
So basically what you're seeing here is things like the room system summary, the call quality that we have, all the different rooms that what they have in terms of devices and manufacturers, the models, whether or not they're healthy, all of that. So my favorite column is actually over here on the health status to see like how these things are running. So really awesome stuff in terms of giving you that visibility across the different rooms that you have configured. But what other tools then do we have to help onboard teams?
So one of the areas that you need to think through when you provision teams is bandwidth. And to help you with that, we just introduced Network Planner, which is currently in public preview. With Network Planner, you can get an idea of required bandwidth consumption for your organization when you move to Teams. As you can see here in the report, Network Planner calculates requirements for deploying Teams across physical locations of your organization.
And one of the other things that you can do in terms of the process of deploying Teams, the desktop client apps, the desktop apps, thanks to the work that we've done with Microsoft Teams and kind of including it as part of the Office deployment packages, it's actually click-to-run based as well. It's part of the click-to-run tool set. So here with the Office customization tool, you go to config.office.com. By the way, all the current apps are there. And as you'd expect, you have the ability then with Teams to add that as part of your packages. It's on by default. One thing to note here is when you select an update channel for the semi-annual channel, itself, it's going to have, as of January 2020, it'll be part of the standard install and also the updates for semi-annual channel for Office. So we've published an entire series actually on Microsoft Mechanics. It's 5 parts. If you go to ak.ms/Office IT series, it'll explain everything about Click to Run, how to configure it, how to troubleshoot it, everything that you'll want to know, and how to even use that within your config manager or Intune environments to get it deployed. So it's a pretty good round of updates, but is there anything else that you can add in terms of additional capabilities?
Yes. We're also releasing in public preview Advisor for Teams. And Advisor for Teams is a new onboarding tool that helps you bring your project team together to plan the best possible deployment of Teams in your organization. Advisor for Teams gives you a shared collaboration space, of course, in the form of a team, and recommended plans. So basically, step-by-step guidance that walks you through how to best deploy the core team's workloads in your organization.
Right, and this is a really great set of updates. And I like how we're thinking across all the major admin areas to improve Teams. But where should I go to learn more?
So if you want to go learn more, go to aka.ms/successwithteams. This is where you can find videos, but also best practices, and most importantly, technical documentation.
Right, and we're also building an entire Microsoft Teams for IT series on Microsoft Mechanics. They're going to cover the foundation. It'll cover Skype to Teams. It'll cover security and compliance, all coming later this fall. So stay tuned for updates there. Go to Microsoft.com/mechanics. Hit subscribe if you haven't already. That's all the time we have for today's show. Thank you for watching, and we'll see you next time.
Thank you.